Look at these things. They look like they were assembled at one of those Chinese electronics markets and sold for 20 bucks. And what is that alien spacecraft of a device? Well, these are future iPhones. And the others, let me introduce you to what became PlayStation 5. The final version doesn't look less alien though. Hi, I'm Romana, a business analyst and product manager at Altexoft. Today, we talk about prototypes in product discovery. The examples that I've shown you come from the physical world. But how do prototypes work in software development? And why do we need them? Okay, what is a prototype? A software prototype is an early product design that users and stakeholders can interact with. Typically, we don't code them, but we use specific tools to mimic how a future application will work, so users can click through screens, get the look and feel, and give us feedback. Prototypes help investors and business partners grasp and buy into your idea, and they help a product team plan, estimate, and test the product before investing too much money, basically validating the concept. But before I talk about prototypes, let me just clarify some terms. A prototype is often confused with the proof of concept or POC and minimum viable product or MVP. Many teams use them interchangeably. It's up to the team to decide what they call their validation product. And yet, there are some distinctions because they all validate different things. A proof of concept, POC, is a rough and early representation of the future product created in the cheapest and fastest way possible, sometimes even within days. The primary purpose is to determine if the product idea is technically feasible and demonstrate to decision makers that this can and should be done. You can't show it to users yet. Perhaps it looks ugly, duct taped together, or doesn't even have an interface. But if it works on a technical level, you're good to go with the development, right? At Altexoft, we do POCs to verify the architecture, the essential data exchange, etc. A prototype is created with more effort, usually with much attention to the product's design. It must illustrate the look and feel of the future application, and we test usability and validate ideas. It may be the next step after a POC as we build the user flow and UX on top of it. Or, as I mentioned before, you can grab tools like Figma, Sketch, or InVision to mimic the interface and some business logic, but it's not a product yet. Finally, an MVP is available for public use. It's our product's early release. It has all the essential features and logic, but nothing else. MVP tests the product market fit. It helps us collect feedback from people who used it and see how the market reacts. Eventually, with an MVP, we'll understand whether users accept the product or if we need to pivot or throw it all away. As a side note, we'll get back to MVPs by the end of this series. In the meantime, let's talk prototypes. So, when do you use a prototype? What are the use cases? There are four main prototype applications. They aren't mutually exclusive. They instead support each other. First, you validate ideas. Prototypes give us a tangible representation of a design. You can share it with others for feedback, and you can make sure you're addressing the actual need. One of the cases that comes to my mind is when a fintech player came to us with their idea for a new app. We suggested building a prototype to validate it with a handful of users. The client agreed, and eventually we didn't make the app. The client and we decided not to. As sad as it sounds, it was actually a good outcome. We went cheap and dirty and stopped before pouring money in the idea that wouldn't work. And that leads me to the next point. Usability testing. You may terminate the entire project. That happens. But the results are almost never that drastic. You catch usability issues early on, answer many user flow questions in advance, decide on specific features. Everyone has seen the cost of error graph. If you catch usability errors before development, you save money, Addressing them on prototypes is much cheaper than in production. You can use prototypes to convey the agreement within your team, the tool for communicating and discussing ideas. As for the business analyst, this is my pain point. You spend hours clarifying requirements, resolving ambiguities and misunderstandings, presenting ideas to the clients, and so on. Prototypes help you have a visual representation. It reinforces documents and gives the team enough accurate details on what we are building. And if we have accurate information and a visual representation of agreement, we estimate better. So, the last use case is time and cost estimation. Watch our video on software estimation here. Great! Now let's talk about versions of prototypes and their fidelity. Fidelity refers to how close a prototype is to the final product. The more functionality, visual design elements, and content it has, the higher its fidelity, right? Normally, we divide prototypes into low and high fidelity ones. Sometimes, high fidelity prototypes are called functional, those you can interact with. Okay, what is a low fidelity prototype? It's an artifact to communicate high-level design concepts and capture basic functionality. It's not interactive, the visual design is incomplete, and it doesn't have much content. Neither does it represent the final look and feel. Say, you can draw the basic designs on sheets of paper or get several screens with wireframes or future sections and buttons and call it a day. Low-fidelity prototypes won't help you gather detailed feedback from users. They'd have to imagine too many things. And these basic prototypes can oversimplify complex ideas. Well, it seems it doesn't have much use. Why do we need that? First, it's a conversation starter. Now there is something to discuss. Second, you can iterate it fast and cheap. It's disposable. Anyone can produce it and bring their ideas to the table. So, you draft out the basic features and workflow. Present these to the team and stakeholders. Then, you can discuss and validate ideas inside the team and iterate early. And finally, you decide what you are going to test later with a greater fidelity. Maybe you don't need a high-fidelity representation of the settings menu for an image-sharing app. You want to test user flow. Or perhaps settings are precisely what must be tested, and you need a better prototype for that, because you are building a financial application. So, if you look at the previous section, it's okay to use low-fidelity prototypes to validate some initial ideas and to use them as the means of agreement inside the team. But you can't use them to catch usability issues or make precise estimations. For this reason, low-fidelity prototypes are the first stage before you go for the higher fidelity. High-fidelity prototypes look and behave as close as possible to the final product. They may not represent the complete feature set, but the prototype is realistic, detailed, dynamic, and functional. They look like a real app or website, have the same content that will appear in the final design, are interactive, and are great for usability testing with real people. Now, they can do everything we want them to do. All use cases apply. You can present and validate the product idea with them. It gives an authentic look and feel. The usability testing results are detailed, and you can capture end-user reactions. They can be coded to mimic actual behavior, or you can use Figma, Sketch, InVision, or other prototyping tools for that. Great! Now that we've discussed when and what, I'd like to share some recommendations on how to employ a prototype as you validate ideas and test usability. Prioritize and prototype only those features that you must validate. High-fidelity prototypes take a lot more effort, so start with low-fidelity ones. Decide what exactly you want to test, and then prioritize features that will make it to a higher-fidelity version. This will help you iterate faster, and your designers won't feel discouraged by having to make lots of changes. If you prioritize the features, you must also understand what exactly you are testing now. Is it a specific flow? Is it the use of a particular interface? Think of that when you run tests with users. Don't get attached to your decisions. Prototypes are designed to be changed and go through many iterations. Don't develop an emotional attachment to your design. It's okay that it will change. Use real assets, real devices with actual performance. When it comes to high fidelity, you need the product to look as authentic as possible and filled with content. Only then can you get trustworthy reactions and feedback. Besides that, people expect a prototype to act as a real thing. If it has a long buffering time or is laggy, these problems will likely skew the results, regardless of how great the flow is. Personalize the prototype. Adjust the prototype features to the different focus groups or scenarios you test. You know, the experience of the registered user and one yet to be onboarded can be completely different. Prepare your audience. Let people know what part of the future product you are testing and what part you aren't. If you don't manage expectations, people will consider that your prototype represents the final product, and they can become biased against the product itself. But don't worry, you can't control everything, so accept all feedback, especially negative. Sometimes you are testing, say, the layout of elements and buttons, but users want to comment that they don't like the colors or fonts. That happens with high-fidelity prototypes. Accept that feedback. Finally, don't be afraid to fail and receive negative feedback. That's precisely why prototypes exist. And eventually, that's part of product discovery. Okay, now I want you to share your tips and tricks when working with prototypes. I'll be happy to discuss them in the comment section below. Leave your ideas, like and subscribe. Since we've tested and iterated prototypes, it's time to move toward an MVP. In my next video, I'll talk about prioritization techniques that help shortlist the features that will make it to your minimum viable product. Stay tuned!